Hi, everybody. This is Kelly Caldwell with Those Were the Days. And on Those Were the Days today, I have two guests with me, Stacia Corey and Margie Russell. And I want to welcome both of you to our program today and a nice day here in Baker. Perhaps I could start, first of all, with Stacia. And Stacia, could you tell us a little about yourself and where you were born and grew up? What kind of family you came from?
I was born in Rosemount, Minnesota, on a farm about 4 miles out of town. And I attended a rural school for the first years of my life. And I had to walk 2 miles, and in those days you didn't get a ride every time you turned around. My father would get out a team of horses if it was exceedingly wet, like a real rainy day, and then throw a blanket over us and take us to school, or in the winter the same way. If it was a blizzard, fine. And of course, Minnesota was much wetter than here, and the trees were beautiful. And I grew up in a family of 10. I was still on the farm. And then I graduated from high school. While I was in high school, I walked 4 miles each way to high school. So that's one reason why I can still walk around the lake today. And I also stayed after school and played basketball. So sometimes in the winter, it was getting pretty dark when I got home. And I graduated in 3 years. I don't think that I was that bright exactly, but it happened that walking that far to school was a problem, and there were two of us, two girls from 1 2 miles away, and we became very, very good friends, and had visited each other until she died about 3 years ago of cancer. Well, we had decided we'd take extra classes if they would let us, and graduated 3 years, and that's what we did. Well, of course, you couldn't do much of anything. I just turned 16 in May. You couldn't go to college, really, because they wouldn't hire you at that age after a year of college. That's what a lot of the teachers had for preparation. So I worked at whatever I could. I even cleaned houses for people. Sometimes I think we only got maybe 50 cents a day. So when I went to go to college, then I worked for my room and board, and the first year was real lonely. I was only 40 miles from home, but you didn't have the bus fare to go home. That's just exactly what it was.
What town was the college in?
In River Falls, Wisconsin.
River Falls, Wisconsin.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And it was just 40 miles from home. So I stayed with and helped take care of an old lady all by myself and cook for her and go to school. And it was kind of depressing at times. Well, then the next year I stayed with a professor and his wife and had worked for my room and board again, and things turned out much nicer.
Well, you started, first of all, maybe I could ask, now your parents, where did they originally come from?
Well, they were always in Minnesota, but their parents came from Ireland. I'm 100% Irish.
Okay, and they would have been there in the through the
1800s. Oh yes, they were. They lived in Minnesota, right around that town, for as I gathered from my parents that they were raised within a few miles of Rosemount.
Well, after teaching out in that area for a year or two, what brought you out into the state of Montana and here in Fallon County?
Well, teachers were a dime a dozen when I graduated from high school or from college,
uh-huh.
And most of the teachers went out after 1 year. But when I found out I could work my room and board at this professor's home, I looked ahead and thought it wouldn't be long before we needed 2 years. So I stayed on. Well, then the only job I could get was a rural school, and I was ready that I could have been in a small town. But after 1 year, that school closed because it was only 2.5 miles from Shakopee, Minnesota, which is a large town. And on the other side of it, about 2 miles away, was a parochial school at a small town named Marystown. And so they decided to close this little public school because some of them could go into the other town. And there were all kinds of advertisements in the paper. Come to Montana and get $100 a month. Wow, that sounds like a lot of money. And so I thought there was one particular school that said it would be 6 months, a 6 month school, because the area around here was beginning to get depressed and not all schools could pay the full 9 months. So I signed up for that one, and it was 6 miles west of Willing. And gravel.
Was that down in the Lame Jones area?
No, it was between Lame Jones and Willard. It was right out in the, it was the Red Hill School is what it was called. And later the Red Hill School, my first school in Montana, was moved up beside me. It's only a block away. It's Fred Schopp's garage.
Oh, okay. Well, when you came into Baker, of course, I assume you came on the train?
I came on the train, and I arrived, I think, just about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I took one look, and all I could see was one tree. And I thought, oh, my goodness, if there's a train going back the other way, I'm getting on it. This looks desolate. But I stuck it out, and the county superintendent met it. There were several teachers that came that same day, and a man by the name of Mr. Marshall met us. He had a Model T Ford, and he took us on out to our respective schools.
What time of the year was this?
It was the very first part of September.
Oh, okay. So you hadn't gotten into a winter yet or anything?
No, I hadn't. But once you got out there, I suppose about 25 miles out of Baker, I didn't see town again until sometime late in the fall.
Well, then when you were there, did you stayed at someone's home?
I stayed just right across the street, the road from the schoolhouse, at the Albert Remelhard home. She was Elmer Williams' sister. I stayed at their house. And they were just, had only been married a year or so, because they had their first youngster while I was there.
Okay, and that brought you to the Fallon County?
That brought me to Fallon County, and by the time that six-month school was up, there was a country school that ran summers, and it was the Fletcher Creek School, and that started in March, and I got out the first part of March from the other school, and I just talked 15 months straight through.
Okay.
With a couple of occasions, you know.
All righty, we'll pick up on this then after we talk with Margie a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Margie, perhaps tell us where. Now you came from the central part of Montana. That's where you were born and raised.
Yes, I was born in a small town in Fergus County. My dad had a Hereford ranch, and we had a lot of land, and that's where I came from. And I say we had a lot of land because everybody worked. I mean, I had two brothers and one sister, and we worked on the ranch when we were small. But anyhow, yes, I was born in the small town in Fergus County. It was Coffee Creek, Montana, and I lived there until I was 11. My mother died then, and I stayed home for possibly another year, and then I was out on my own, and I went to 3 different high schools before I graduated from Missoula High. It depended on where I could get a job. I always got a job from my board and room and $1 a week. And that's when I went to high school, in a small high school near where I was born. It was called Arrow Creek High School, and that was near Stanford. That's the central part of Montana. Mm-hmm. And then I went to Frenchtown High School, which is a small town west of Missoula, and because I got a good job there. And so then when I graduated, I felt that I ought to go to a larger high school. And so the last 2 years, I went to Missoula High and was fortunate enough to be able to work for my board and room and some money. And I worked for the head football coach at the University in Missoula.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had a really interesting life. And I worked there for 3 years. I worked 2 years when I was in high school. And then I went to the University in Missoula 1 year and still worked for Mr. Fessenden, and I took care of their little boys, what I did when I went to high school. And then after that, I went to Bozeman for 2 years, and then completely ran out of money. Remember, this was in the late 30s and early 40s, and nobody had any money. And so from Bozeman, I was there for 2 years. And then I decided that I would have to hone my skills. I typed and took shorthand and everything, and so I thought that what I ought to do is go to a business college. And that's where I met Gene. He had gone to the university, and that's also what he was doing. He was out there going to business college, as I was. And I was very fortunate in Spokane. I used to work for my board and room and a little money. I worked in a home, in a banker's home, and they were from Holland. And she taught me so much about the way they used to eat and the way they cooked, and I was the cook for them. And went to a couple years to business college until I could, felt that I could get a decent job. And I had a wonderful experience with these people because they spoke very little English. But he owned a bank, and it was an international bank in Spokane. So I was able to, I learned a lot from her. And then I finally got a good job. Oh boy, happy day. I worked for the electrical engineer who was the chief designer for Grand Coulee Dam. So I hit the jackpot there, had a wonderful job. I did, when I went to business college, I learned to be a law secretary, and I learned to be a medical secretary, and so I got a job with an electric engineer, and that was entirely different because I really had to learn to use his terms and took dictation, and was very fortunate. I had a good job, and I worked there until I got married. And Gene, of course, patriotic Gene, he had to get into the service immediately as soon as the war broke out. So he joined the service, and we were married while he was in the service.
What year was that then?
That was in 1942.
Okay.
And so then I traveled all over the United States with him. We were in Texas and New York and Spokane and Seattle. We just went every place. I went every place with him until he was shipped overseas, of course. Then I couldn't go. But I had my oldest child when Gene was gone, and that's when I came to Baker. When he went overseas, Gene's family just insisted that I come home and live here with them because little did they know I was really independent. I'd been on my own for so many years. But I did come home and to Baker here, and that's when I came to Baker. It was in 44 is when I came to stay here while Gene was overseas. And then when he came home, why, we just stayed. We had no intention of staying in Baker. Because Gene already had a job in Spokane, and that's where we both went to school, and I worked there for a long time, and so we expected to go to Spokane. But when we got here, he got here one afternoon. He had flown into Great Falls when they mustered out the kids in World War II. That's where, in Montana, everybody flew into Great Falls. And he came down. Somebody brought him down because he had 5 years in the service, and so they thought they should treat him well, I guess. So they brought him down, and our oldest child was running around calling Martin, Gene's father, Daddy. And so poor old Gene, he came in one afternoon, and his dad said, "Here are the keys, Gene, I'm going to Arizona." So we stayed in Baker.
And it had Russell clothing, kind of, here it is.
Yes, that's true. And that's how I came to Baker. I could say a little bit about the 30s. That's when I graduated from high school and had left home about 33. My mother died in 32, and then about 34 is when I left home. And it just amazes me now that when you read history books or talk to people who lived through the 30s, at the time, it didn't make too much difference to me because I had a job and I had a place to live and I had enough food and I was going to school, and I guess that's all I ever thought that life would be. Well, then when things finally straightened up, it was wonderful. I thought during the war, you know, and when I was married, my goodness, Gene got a pretty good check. And I thought it was absolutely wonderful. But now that I think back, it must have been really hard. But when you have association with a farm, you always have something to eat. Mm-hmm. You never had to worry about because you grow it. But other people talk about the 30s as it was bad, I guess. But we didn't, I guess I didn't know very much about the world because it didn't seem to bother me. And then after things got good, you know, in the 40s and after the war, my, it was great. But I think about the dirty 30s, and I guess it was kind of bad because that's when my mother died and nobody had any money. And I remember a lot of people worked for the WPA. And the other day I heard what WPA, it's work. You probably don't even know what the WPA is, do you?
Gee whiz, I've heard that if I could think about it a little, maybe I could.
So it's works production or something. And it was a program that Franklin Roosevelt mm-hmm. had instigated, and it was to help people have jobs and get paid because there was no other jobs. But I thought about that the other day. I heard it on television, and I thought, well, then they had CCC camps. Mm-hmm. That was for young men who had nothing else to do. You know, they didn't have any money for school.
Civilian Conservation Corps. Yes,
I can't remember. Works something for WPA. But I can't believe that we survived the 30s. And if you've never had too much, you don't really notice it. And mm-hmm. and I really didn't notice it very much. And so I finally got up high school.
Well, how about you, Stacia? How do you remember the 30s? You just came into Fallon County right at the very, very beginning and were teaching on your own.
Yes, and that first part, like 30 and 31, those years were okay because I was getting a paycheck. Well, then after I quit teaching, and we were farming, why, things were looking quite rosy. But that first year of our married life on the farm, we went to Opeachy Park down near Ypalaca to celebrate 4th of July. All of the neighbors were going, and so many people would gather there and have a picnic. And we knew that there'd been rain, because it rained a little on us at Opeachy Park, but we had no idea what we'd be met with when we got home. There had been a devastating hailstorm, and I don't know how large the hailstones were, but they broke the windows on the one side of the house, and of course there was water all over the floor, and the furniture wet where it had blown in, and there wasn't a spear of grain left on 4th of July. Well, that was a bad year. So Ray worked out for farmers for a dollar a day, putting up hay. And a dollar a day went quite a ways on groceries when you paid, you know, like 10 cents for a quart of milk and 10 cents for a loaf of bread. But I baked my own bread. And then we tried another year of farming, and that's when the drought hit. And it was terrible. You just wait every day for rain that didn't come. And the MDU was expanding a little bit at that time. Harry Schroth was the manager here. And Ray's brother was working at the post office as a clerk in the post office and didn't live very far from Harry. And Grant had heard about this. They were putting on a crew to work on the pipeline between here and Belle Fouche. And he walked over to Schroth's house and asked if there was any chance that his brother could get on. He said he was a good, strong fellow, and Harry said, bring him in, or have him come in. Well, that was his first year, start with the MDU at 40 cents an hour, and that just seemed like $1 million to us. Mm-hmm. Well, that fall, then we moved into town and rented a house for $8 a month. And Ray was laid off back in October, and we got through the winter because we saved the money, and the folks were still on the farm, and they had meat, and we lived in that house for a year, and then the next year we moved into a modern house, $12 and a half a month, and Mr. Price owned that at that time, but Dad, it's a house for Cole Maddie's that they have now, but it's been built out since. And those were still in the 30s, but at least there was work during the summer, and there was Louis LaCrosse who would say, oh yes, you're going to get your groceries. I know, I've known those Corys long enough, and I've had enough to do with ranchers. They pay in the fall, those ranchers, and he said, I know that the minute you get a job in the spring, it'll pay up. So we, and same way with Mrs. John Gunderson, oh yes, I'm going to deliver the milk every day.
Yeah, you mentioned the LaCrosse there. Yeah. Didn't most of your children all work?
Yes, then the boys, all three of them worked for Louis LaCrosse.
I thought they all did at one time or another.
Yes, they did, and so they all got their little starts there with their spending money. But the Dirty 30s were bad. You know, you just have to admit you never saw anything as dry as the land would be, and you'd wonder how the farmers and ranches really got along.
Was Ray a native of Fallon County, this area?
No, Ray was born in Conway, North Dakota, and he came here when he was about 2 years old. So I believe he was born in 1906, so it must have been 1908 when they came here, when many of the homesteaders came at that mm-hmm. time, and they came from all over. So that's when.
No, Stacia, you continued then to teach.
At that time they said married women couldn't teach. So I gave away a lot of my materials and things to single girls. Well, then all of a sudden the war hit, you know, and even before that, a lot of the people found out they could make a lot better money by going to the West Coast. Ray's family all moved out of here it must have been about 1933 or 4, because they heard there was a demand for men to work in the paper mills mm-hmm. out in Oregon. So they went out there, and then of course when the war broke out, people got very, very good paying jobs in the shipyards. So many of the teachers even went out there. So I went back to teaching again to finish out a term for a teacher out at the Crow School, which would have been across the road from the tiny Engesser place. And Quincy Sinclair's lived out there that year. Well, the teacher who was there was married to a fellow from Plevna, and he was transferred up to Lindsay, Montana, I think it was, north of Glendive, in an elevator. And she got so lonesome, she just cried day after day, and Mel Snyder, who was the superintendent at that time, came to me and asked me if I wouldn't go out there, and I said, oh, I just couldn't go. But it was December, and I had two small children. Well, Ray was laid off, and I finally consented to go because Sinclair said we could live in there upstairs at their house. So Ray took care of the children until March or April, and he went back to work for MDU, and Mrs. Sinclair took over. And I stayed another year out there, and by that time I was expecting my first son. And I stayed home. I vowed I wouldn't go do any teaching until everybody was in school, and when my youngest was 5 years old, teacher at Fertile Prairie, her husband was ill in February, and she had to quit. And they practically camped on my doorstep, and I said I wouldn't leave Pat. And, okay, bring him along, bring out a crib or anything, let him sleep, finish out the 10 weeks or whatever it left that spring. I stayed 4 more years. Conditions were so bad one winter that for weeks we couldn't get to school, and it was only a mile off the main 12 as the crow flies, but we had to walk 2 miles to get there. Nobody had a horse and sled. Mm-hmm. So we'd meet out on the highway, and no, we couldn't go. And they decided if I'd come back, they'd move the school up onto the highway the next year. They did. And so I stayed there, and then Mr. Hefty and some of the school board members asked me to come in. They had asked me before, and I said, not if I had to teach my own children. I'd was doing well out there, and I'd stay. Well, then they split the fifth grade, and I came in.
Mm-hmm. They had Lincoln School built then?
Yeah. No, they didn't yet, because we had half-day school. They were working on it.
Oh, okay.
I only taught half-day, you know, but we'd teach one of the fifth grade teachers would teach in the morning and the other in the afternoon, and I had the morning.
Oh. I'm trying to think back here. I must have had half-day school somewhere along
yes.
the line.
Were you in Pat's room?
Yes.
Well, you had in the fourth grade.
I think it is, right.
It was the fourth grade, because that's when I said I came in and wouldn't have to teach my own, because Pat was in the fourth grade that year.
But the fifth, in the fifth grade, I was fortunate enough to have you for a teacher, and I remember that very well.
Yes, we were in the south end of the old, of the Washington School, which was quite a nice school. Mm-hmm.
Well, Margie, then, when you were here after World War II then, and the keys to Russell's clothing were kind of handed to you, they said, we're going to Arizona. And how did you adjust to everything then?
Well, it was a bit of a shock. I mean, we expected to go back to Spokane, and we didn't, but it was all right. I thoroughly enjoyed living here in Fallon County. And, of course, we raised four girls. And I became very interested and involved in 4-H work, which I did for 25 years, and loved every minute of it. But I was very occupied. Gene didn't want me to work. He wanted me to be home, and so that was fine. And Sundays, we all used to go down to the store and clean it up, and he'd do the books, but we used to do it as a family. And I enjoyed it very much. It was a good school system, and we enjoyed it all. And the girls think very fondly of Fallon County and Baker. And I enjoyed it very much. I became involved in, oh dear, the American Red Cross and the blood program, and was very occupied and enjoyed it. I think that's why I just stay here, because I like all the facilities. And you know, during that course of the time since 40s, our schools were built up, and then they put the complex in, and I enjoy the pool so much. I've gone ever since it was opened, and there are so many facilities here that I liked. And of course, you know, we increased all of that during the time when I first came to Baker, and thoroughly enjoyed every bit of it, and have just stayed on. It was great having the store, too. It was fun to have everybody, you know, come into the store and everything. It was a wonderful way to make a living. And then Gene retired. And the month that he retired, in March, when he retired, that was in 1977, he decided one day he was going to build a new store, because he thought that the store needed a new building. And so we built the new store building in 77, and they moved in September. And then he sold the store to Matt, and it's still there after 75 years.
Well, as we speak right now, just a week or two ago, you were down there for the 75th birthday of Russell Clothing. Mm-hmm. And so that would have been 1916.
Yes.
And was it April when they
opened
the store?
Yes, it was Gene's father, my father-in-law, Martin, opened the store on April 10th when he was 20. That was his 25th birthday. And making him 100 years old on April 10th. And I didn't know that until they checked at the paper and mm-hmm. and found the exact date. I thought they opened it in March, but I realized that it was in April, which was very interesting. And you'd be surprised the number of people who were in for that 75th anniversary, the number of older people who knew Russell's all that time. There are quite a few people who are still around and very happily.
There are an awful lot of natives left here in the Fallon County area.
Yes, there are. I was very impressed with that, because you know, a lot of them, they came in. I was serving coffee and cake during the celebration, and they came in and reminisced. And I wish I could have had a tape, because so many of them told stories about this or that, and they talked about the older people who, you know, who used to be here, who are no longer here. And I wish I had a tape then, because there were lots of good stories going around about, you know, how they handled some situations in the store, and one of the somebody came in and said, you know, we couldn't afford shoes one winter, and Martin lined up all the little kids and said, sit down here, we'll have shoes. And this mother said, if it hadn't been for them, we wouldn't have had shoes that winter. And there were a lot of personal things that Jean's dad did, and of course then Jean just carried it on too, but it was very interesting, and it's a happy occasion that it lasted 75 years.
At the time, I believe, were there three clothing stores in Baker in the late 40s and 50s? There was Penny's, they put in
yes.
their store, and then Samsel's.
Samsel's, yes. Mr. Samsel's father was here, mm-hmm. and also his uncle. Mm-hmm. They had stores here early, and then Penny's was always mm-hmm. here, yes.
Uh-huh. Did Eddie Nelson always work there for you?
Well, he worked there, yes, he worked there a long time. He worked for Gene's dad when Gene was in college and was in the service. Mm-hmm. Eddie had worked there, but he came from Spearfish, or Deadwood, I think. And he worked there a long time. And then when he came home from the service, and Gene came home, why, they decided that they'd, you know, go in. And yes, Eddie, he worked for Martin for a long time before, when, you know, when Gene was younger. And was very... They had a good time, those two, at the store. They have a lot of pictures. They used to have crazy costumes for crazy days, and I can just hear them both giggling and laughing about it. It was a good association.
Well, Eugene was also very active with the Cub Scouts, as I recall.
Yes, he was. He was Cub Master for 5 years and worked in Scouts a long time. They used to kid him because we just had girls, and here he had a men's clothing store, and he worked in Scouts constantly. But yes, he was Cub Master for a long time. He had the little boys and thoroughly enjoyed them. Mm-hmm. Yes, and of course he had a lot of other interests. He was county chairman of the cemeteries, and that's when we voted to have that the county would do some work. I mean, provide money for the cemeteries. And he got that set up, and he worked for all the cemeteries. And we often used to say we went on a safari, and he'd go and all over the county. We'd drive all over the county and check out all the cemeteries. And if there was a grave that needed fixing, well, then he made sure that somebody went out there and did that. But he was very interested in the cemeteries and did a lot of work. Got a lot of trees growing in a lot of them, and always kept checking. And he gave the county commissioners a complete book of all the cemeteries. You'd be surprised how many there are in Fallon County. And he has pictures of all of them, and exactly the location and which road to take, because they're little used roads, some mm-hmm. of them. And it was hard to find them. I remember we had a Jeep then, and we were driving over all the county trying to find this one cemetery, and we found it and didn't have any fence or any markers or anything. We finally found that one. But he was very interested in the county mm-hmm. and worked long and hard for most everything that was here. Do you have time to talk about the radio station?
Sure.
There's time? Well, I think it's so interesting that the radio station is so well and doing well. And when they started it, it's about 26, 27 years ago now.
1964.
64.
Went on the air.
Yes, well, I hope that somebody has been writing a history about the radio station, because there were 7 guys that started that radio station originally. And they had a lot of problems. There were things that happened that you wouldn't believe, but it all came out. Everybody hung in, and it is highly successful after that many years. And that was one of Gene's babies. He really thought that was the thing to do. They, just about 3 of them got together and said, we ought to have a radio station in Baker. And it just grew and grew. And then there were 7 of them, and then they put resources together and
that was the Empire Broadcasting Company then.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes it is. And then Russ Newell, we were so pleased about Russ Newell coming in. He was young and had a lot of ideas, and has you know it's successful, and that was one of the best things I think that happened in that period. But that was another thing that Gene was very interested in. So, of course, he was always interested in the bank, but I'm sure you've got lots of history of the bank.
Yeah, he was an officer in the bank for quite some time, wasn't he?
Yes, he was a director. Well, his father was. I don't really know when Martin went into the bank, but he was associated with Davy Bickle, and he was one of the men who started the bank, and I don't know what year Martin went in, but he was a director until he died in 52, and then Gene took his place, and he was in there until he retired, and then he gave it up. But that's another long story about the bank, that they've done well, and he was always interested in the bank.
Stacia, when did you retire from teaching?
Well, I taught in Baker from 52 until 74. I retired, I was 65 in May that year, and I had been asked to, if I considered teaching another year, if the board would go along with it. Well, I'd kind of made up my mind I would cutting it off that year, but I said, well, if they thought it would be okay, but I didn't want to cause any trouble, you know, by teaching beyond. Well, the men took it to the board. It was Mr. Erickson, I believe, at the time, and the board thought it over for a while, and they said, well, the only thing is we have retired some at 65 who probably would have wanted to teach, and it may cause hard feelings. And I had worlds and worlds of subbing. I didn't have to worry that I wasn't teaching. So, and then I had the spelling bee, county spelling bee, for about 20 years. Mm-hmm. And in the 20 years that I taught, I had youngsters in all the sports, you know, and music especially. And so I said with my youngest one, he started going to the music festivals over at Glendive when he was just a few months old, and he was raised there for the next umpteen years. And then on top of having my own family graduate from Baker, I had a brother who came out, I believe it was in 39, and spent his last 2 years here because my mother had moved to Minneapolis off the farm. My father had died quite a number of years ago, and she figured she couldn't hack it anymore. And she was worried about the youngest boy getting in with the wrong people. Mm-hmm. So he came out and finished high school and played football here and has football knees to right now that he's suffering from. And through those years, of course, I had taken part in different organizations to the point where I don't think there was a drive that I wasn't out house to house. And the same thing, I had been president of our Altar Society Church for so many years that I think when people saw me coming, they had a can of vegetables ready or some money.
Thought you were out on another campaign.
Yes, on another campaign. And it seemed like the years flew by, and before you knew it, they were all through, and four of them graduated from college. The one who didn't graduate from college says she has spent the longest time in college of all of them because she is now in charge of the, my daughter Norma is in charge of the student loans at Bozeman, and she's been there for 12 years and of course was involved in this strike, which she didn't really like too well, but they had to do it. And during that time then, in 1967, I went through a real traumatic year because Ray had a heart attack in January. He had just turned 60 in December, and we thought he was as healthy as a horse, although he had diabetes. And he was to spend a month in the hospital, and during that month, lo and behold, the school burned down. I was teaching in Longfellow, the old high school. And I was in the room with him at the time. I'd heard the whistle, but I didn't pay too much attention to it. And pretty soon, one of the nurses came and called me out of the room, and she said, I thought you might like to know that there is a fire up at the Longfellow School, but I wouldn't worry about it or something like that. The fire department is on the scene. So then it wasn't very long, and Coleman Crawford was working at the hospital, and I believe he came in the room, and he said, "I don't want to startle you, but the school is getting pretty well burned." And of course that upset Ray too, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I left thinking I could get in my room, but there was no way. No one had ever thought that it would progress the way it did. And so we only had things left in the sixth grade room, one corner, books or anything, everything was destroyed. And I had, I don't know how many years of pictures of the youngsters and, mm-hmm. and because I had such a good place to store things in my room. Well, when the fire was over, of course, everybody was devastated, and we wondered what in the world we were going to do. Well, I believe we spent about 2 days getting over it while the administration made arrangements for us to teach half days up at the high school, and we had half days with the 7th and 8th, and we managed to get through it. And I enjoyed all the years I taught. I had some wonderful parents. I think that Baker has. And I took advantage of being alone, I guess. I've done a lot of traveling that we had planned to do together. I've been to Europe several times, and I've been to Hawaii, I've been to Alaska, I've been to this, down to the islands of Florida. I'm going to Ireland again in July, and it just seems like I've had a good life.
Well, Margie, you do a lot of traveling. It seems yes. that every time we're trying to catch you, you're on the run again.
Yes. Well, Gene and I did a lot of traveling after he retired. Uh-huh. We did. We took a lot of cruises and went up to Alaska and the Caribbean. And then last fall, I took a trip to Spain and Portugal, and we went over into Africa. That was a nice experience. And that was the first trip I'd taken without Gene, and it was really a traumatic thing, but I did really well. I was surprised. I think I found out that nothing is impossible. Yes, I did. I thoroughly enjoyed traveling, and we had some wonderful trips, too. I keep thinking that my kids, if they ever are able to go someplace, that I would just love to go someplace with my children, but everybody is so busy, and everybody works, and so I haven't been able to go with my children very much on any trips, but hopefully I will be able to do that. But yes, we had some wonderful trips, and I'm so happy that we were able to do that before Gene died, and it was great.
Marty, you and Stacia then have been friends for years and years then.
Well, through church a
yes,
lot of it. We
yes.
had to work mm-hmm. together. And Bertie, Jean's mother, was a real good friend of mine.
Mm-hmm.
She was older than I, but we worked together so much.
In the church.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
In those days we had to make a lot of our own money, you know, and giving dinners and all. But
yes.
I've known Marge, well, all the years she's been here, I guess, because of the store.
Yeah.
And I taught to a vacation Bible school and a Bible school and religious instruction catechism for, I suppose, I got a plaque for 25 years, but I started when I was about 15 years old.
Yeah.
So it's been, Baker's been fun. People would say, "What do you see in that part of the country?" I say, "You
yes.
have to live there. You just have to live there to know."
Well, Stacia, you've also been very active here with the Fallon County Library.
Yes.
And the library board. You were mm-hmm. president of the board.
And I think I finished out somebody's term, and then you were allowed 2 terms. And
mm-hmm.
I think about 13 years I was on the board, library board. And then I'm on the Council on Aging. I'm on the RSVP. I'm on, I'm one of the officers and ARP, so we have quite a few of the older generation, I think, to take part in those things.
Margie and Stacia, is there anything that you would like to add that we haven't covered on, as we're running out of time here?
Let's see.
One thing that I really do feel sad about, we had 4 daughters, and we educated them all, and all of them are gone. Not one is in Montana. That's one thing I lament about. But they all are, 3 of them are on the coast and 1 is in Nebraska. And I really, I wish that there were more opportunities in Fallon County so that the young people didn't leave that way. But one of them is in the medical field. She is in administration, she runs various clinics in Portland, and two of them are in teaching, and their husbands are in specialized fields. One is in the fish and game, and one is a graphic designer on the coast. And it just didn't seem, I mean, the jobs weren't there when they got out of college. I really do feel sad about that, because we have lots of good, outstanding young people who graduate from Baker High School, and then they go to college, and then so many of them leave, and that does make me sad. I wish it were possible that they could have stayed. But if they get in a field and go on and get their graduate degrees, like three of mine have, why, it's, and incidentally, Stacia taught one of my children too, my second one, in the fifth grade.
Yes, and she was a delight. I think it's fun to talk to some of these youngsters. Now that I am still subbing, I've had the grandchildren of some of the children, youngsters I have, and their faces kind of light up, and I sometimes say, I had your daddy, I had your mommy. But my youngsters, too, are kind of far-flung. Of course, Marlene, I was fortunate enough to keep Marlene here because she married Denzel and stayed here. But Norma lives in Bozeman and has 8 youngsters. Just one of them was in Saudi Arabia as a lieutenant who was in the AWACS planes, and we're so glad she's home. And Norma's husband was, he's a splicer for electrical companies. And then Jimmy got his PhD, and he's had quite a life because he has he teaches in Socorro, New Mexico, but he has had a couple of Fulbright scholarships, and he spent 1 year in Jordan, and that summer he rented a house in southeast England, and I was fortunate enough to be able to go over 3 years ago and go all around that area. And now this year he's in Bulgaria on the same deal with a sabbatical from his college in New Mexico. And this summer he and his wife Lana, who is an O'Connor from here, are renting a cottage, and a number of us are going over to visit. And then Howard graduated from Bozeman, and he went into the Naval Flight Program where he spent several months in Pensacola, where he couldn't even see his wife and young daughter. And then he spent 5 years with the Navy, and he said he'd love to stay in it, but he had 2 children by then, and he said it wasn't the life for a father and a husband. So he came home and went to work for TWA, and he could... he has 20 years in with them, I believe. He's going to retire at 55 anyway, and he'll have 25 years in. And then Norma, of course, is the one that lives in Bozeman, and she raised 8 children. And Howard has 2, Jimmy has 5, Marlene has 5 girls, and Pat married Cheryl Cox from here, and they have their oldest one graduated from high school at Bozeman this year, and he has a very good job as he and his partner have an insurance business that they just sell mortgage insurance to banks and such. And I've enjoyed them all. I have 24 grandchildren and the 10th great-grandchild coming up in June.
Okay. Well, Stacia Corey and Margie Russell, we want to thank you very much for joining us today on Those Were the Days. Thank you.
It was a pleasure. Thank you. Yes, it's...